Coming up next, learn how traditional Japanese drums inspire today's performers. Discover the basics of Buddhism. Find out how ancient storytelling techniques have been given a modern twist. And understand what it takes to put on a large community festival. It all starts now on FunAddicts.tv.
Well, hi, I'm Joni. This is another fabulous day to have some fun. What do you think, Rich?
I agree. Today we're going to take you to the 72nd annual Obon Festival in San Jose's Japantown.
Hey, did you know that this is one of only three Japantowns left in the United States?
It's also one of the oldest. The Obon Festival features traditional dance, food, games, and music.
Ooh, music. I'm really looking forward to listening to some of that music, especially seeing the taiko drumming. Now, I've been wanting to learn how to play those taiko drums for a very long time. I'm also planning on attending the Buddhism 101 classes. You know, maybe I'll get enlightened.
Well, you know, this is our first time here at the festival, so there's a lot for us to discover. Let's start exploring it right now.
Let's.
Japanese Americans all over the country celebrate Obon, or Festival of the Dead, in July or August. The 2007 San Jose Obon Festival filled adjacent areas and much of the street in front of the event's sponsor, San Jose Buddhist Church, Betsuin. There were many game booths for young and old, and a bingo parlor with a wide assortment of prizes. Two areas had plenty of seating for guests to dine on a variety of food, including chicken and beef teriyaki, udon, sushi, and tempura. Some events were held at the church's main temple, but the largest crowds gathered around the center stage in the middle of the street. Several of the performances featured taiko, which in Japanese simply means drum. But here in the United States, it usually refers to the art form of ensemble taiko drumming.
That was totally amazing. That was so entertaining. I just feel like my heart is pounding as much as those drums were. Tell me a little bit about the San Jose, your company there.
Okay, we're called San Jose Taiko. We started here right at this temple at the San Jose Buddhist Church in 1973. And originally started as a youth project to try to get the youth involved in something that was cultural, but also related to our heritage as Japanese Americans. But many people from the community wanted to join in, so it rapidly became a community-based group, basically. And we started out as a hobby, just playing for fun, but now it's like a full-time professional ensemble that we support also.
Excellent. So tell me, what is the difference? I know that in Native American we have drumming circles, and in the African culture we have also some prevalent of drumming. Tell me the difference here on taiko drumming.
Well, taiko in Japan as an instrument is hundreds and hundreds of years old, has been used for many different kind of purposes and occasions. In Japan, you'll find it within the temple accompanying the religious ceremonies. You'll find it also within the theater, like kabuki theater, where the taiko is not only used as an instrument to accompany music, but also sound effects, like the door closing or thunder or lightning or something like that. But most popular in Japan are the festivals, and when you go to the festivals, you'll hear the taiko being played, accompanying the singing and dancing and the celebration. So the taiko has come to America in our own Japanese American communities in that same way, at our, like this Obon festival, where you see the taiko accompanying the celebration. But the group drumming style that we're doing, or what we call kumi daiko, is actually relatively new, even in Japan. It only started in the, after World War II, so in the about the early 50s, mid-50s or so, that this particular style, where you just see taiko alone, without singing or dancing really, playing together. And so it's an art form that's really growing right now, both in Japan and here in the United States. When we started Sansei Taiko in 1973, we were the third group to begin here in the United States. And now there's about maybe 200 groups that exist all over the North America.
Now, in terms of purchasing these types of drums, can you tell me the difference of the types of drums that you have?
We're using a whole variety of different types and sizes that you can, as you see. And the drums, you know, they are at various prices. A large drum, like the largest one you saw, it could be very expensive coming from Japan, say around $25,000, $30,000 at least. A lot of the drums or taiko made here in the United States are made by the individual groups, so they're handmade drums. And they do that in order to maintain the cost, because it's so expensive to buy a drum from Japan. And what's happened here in the United States is that there's been a long time ago a style that's developed of taking a wine barrel and using that wine barrel to develop and make a taiko drum out of it. In Japan, the taiko, the large barrel-sized drums are actually carved out of a single piece of wood from a tree trunk. And so in order to eliminate that cost and also use resources here, we're using a wine barrel concept to make our drums. And so there's a whole variety of different styles that's going on to develop taiko here.
I first saw the style about 7 years ago when we were approaching the new millennium, and I was fascinated then, and I've been looking for this type of drum everywhere, and I still haven't been able to until I came to the festival this afternoon. And so is it called a taiko drum each size? Is there a different name for each type of drum?
Each drum does have a different name for its particular size and style. Taiko is a generic word in Japanese for all drums, all the different drums. So when you say taiko, it refers to all the different kind of drums coming from Japan. But each one, like say, like this one here that's tied by rope, it's called an oketo drum. And then the smaller tenor drums are called a shime. The mid-sized drums are the chudaiko, and the largest drum is called the odaiko. So there are various sizes and drums and names for each drum.
Well, I noticed that they are in stands as well. So it's just not only the drum, but then you have the stands that are different for me. And I noticed that, would you call those drumsticks?
Yes, they are drumsticks. In Japanese, we call them bachi, but they're the different drumsticks that we use. And each drum will have a different kind of stick or wood that we're using. So they're not necessarily all the same for each whatever particular kind of drum.
So each drum would have a different type of stick that would be used to play its music.
Right, right. And then it could be the density of the wood, from using birch to a very hard wood like a Japanese white oak. So it depends on the sound we're trying to achieve and also the type of drum we're playing.
How long would it take to make a drum?
It can vary depending on your own skills, because as you can see, it's like an art form of itself, a craftsman's craft of itself to make these drums. But it would take probably several months over a period of time if you're not working on it all the time in order to actually build a drum.
Now, what do you like best about doing this?
I guess what we, all of our members too, it seems like, is what I enjoy the best is that we're playing together as a group, and it's an ensemble activity. And although you can see solo taiko players, for us at San Jose Taiko, it's really the joy of playing together and creating the music and our whole form as an ensemble. And so
It was a real crowd pleaser, and I noticed that you were able to get the crowd involved as well with that type of dance. Can you tell me about that dance again? Because I'd sure like to learn how to do that.
We're actually doing it at the Obon again tonight, so you could come and do it tonight. It's written by one of our members, actually our artistic director, PJ Hitabayashi, who wrote the piece. And she wrote it as in order to incorporate dance into our style of playing, so it's not just the taiko itself. And it was slowly adopted by the Sansei Buddhist Church to be one of the Obon dances that's done here in the evenings. And it's a piece that PJ's been teaching to other taiko groups, so you're going to be seeing different versions of that piece with different taiko groups throughout the United States.
I just have a couple more questions for you. Now, is there any spiritual aspect to your drumming?
Not really, although we did start at the temple here. There's not a a direct link to Buddhism or any other kind of religious thing. I guess we do have our own philosophy that we base our style on and how we practice our drum. There's elements of a martial arts style to it and that kind of dedication, but we really base it upon the musicality of the group also.
Now, how many members do you have in your group?
We currently have about 18 members performing in a group, and it varies year by year. People kind of come and go, but right now there's 18 members.
Now, if people wanted to learn more about being a part of your group or more about this type of style of drumming, where would they go?
Go to our website. It's www.taiko.org. That's T-A-I-K-O.org. And on our website, you can see our calendar of events, where we're going to be playing next, or we have some workshops coming up at different times, so you could sign up and come and play taiko yourself.
Right then, at the workshop itself?
Right, it's a hands-on workshop. We teach you the basics, and it's geared for people who've never played before, so it's a great experience, and people have great fun. We have people of all ages coming to our workshops.
Well, you count me there, for sure. Thank you for spending time with us this afternoon.
Thank you very much. Okay. Hope to see you soon.
I will. I'm serious. See you.
Storytelling come about, and how is it different from other forms of storytelling?
It's actually a format that dates back to maybe a couple thousand years almost, as the Buddhist monks would travel around Asia doing their little PowerPoint presentations to help people understand the message they were giving out. They found that they could use picture cards to enhance their storytelling. But the modern history of this format, which is called kamishibai, what happened in the Great Depression in Japan, when everyone was out of work, and someone realized that he could tell stories in the street to make money. And again, to enhance the stories, he would use some picture cards. And the way these work is, on the front here is the picture that the audience is seeing, and then the performer is always reading off the bottom of the deck. So And you can also see there's a tiny thumbnail image of the image that the audience is seeing, so you can know that you're matched up. And the wonderful thing about this, in contrast to, say, reading a picture book, is that you don't have to turn away from your audience as you're changing the card or changing the scene. You just pull the card out. And in this story, this is the most popular kamishibai in Japan right now. Do you want to show it? Or?
Okay.
I mean, Hazuki is better at performing this one than I am.
This is okiku, okiku, okiku nare, which means grow bigger. Grow bigger, illustrated and written by Noriko Matsui. Oink, 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 boo, 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 boo. Boo, boo is oink in Japanese. There's a tiny little pig. He wants to become bigger. Would you like to help him to get bigger? Let's say grow bigger in Japanese, because he just came from Japan. One, two, three. 大きく大きく大きくなれ. Well, here, you know, we, you know, show kids how to say in Japanese. And then, you know, 大きく大きく大きくなれ. Yeah, he's much bigger. Oink, oink, boo, 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 boo. He's very happy.
Now, I noticed you mentioned you've also adapted this into kind of your own updated version. What exactly did you do differently then?
Our background is in web design, actually. So we took at this from sort of a web design standpoint. And I've actually done presentations to Ajax programmers and people who do these interactive websites like Google Maps, and getting them to think of this as a data presentation format, where typically when you would see a PowerPoint presentation, you turn your back to the audience and you read bullet points to them, and it's really annoying. And actually, studies have shown that it confuses the audience to see what they're reading at the same time. So on our cards, we have, again, the picture on the front. This is Momotaro, a story we adapted from Japanese. We have our words in English on the back, along with a pronunciation key. And then there's kind of a little indexing method down here that might be like tabs on a website. And then, as we speak, we read the card, and we change it slowly. And the echo for video production in this way is that it's like a transition, like a video transition. If you're doing something in cinematic and you want it to be a very fast, startling transition, like in this scene, the woman has just discovered this enormous peach, and she takes it home and decides to cut it open. And so you might want to have a very slow crossfade transition, then all of a sudden whip it out at the end, and you can see the surprise. Whereas if you're doing a more subtle transition, you can go at a typical rate, and it's becomes like a crossfade effect or a cut effect that you might use in video. So we kind of try to think about those types of transitions as we're telling the story.
So how long have you guys been doing this?
We started 2004.
2004, yeah.
Yeah. We have two books out now. We did Momotaro, our first, and then we found that audiences liked it so much, we did Jack and the Beanstalk, figuring it was a story that Western audiences would know better.
So do you guys rewrite the stories, or do you write your own stories? Who does the illustrations?
Oh, that's a good question also. We collaborate with some illustrator friends. This one was done by Mario Uribe, who is a Japanese scholar. He's actually a Mexican-American, but he spent a lot of time in Japan leading cultural tours. And in addition to that, he used to be an animator at Disney. So he's got this whole, you can see as we move on through the story, kind of animal sidekick thing going on that he picked up at Disney. And so we would we'd write the text, and our stories are a little bit text heavy, we're working on that, and then send it to the illustrator, and then they'll come back with illustrations, then we assemble it all in the computer and print it in South San Francisco.
That's great. So how can people find out how to get your stories and find out more about your method of storytelling?
Probably the best place is at storycardtheater.com, our website. We have lots of tips for storytellers up there, as well as history of the format and a schedule of our upcoming performances. And then people can also buy our books there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
First of all, tell me your background here at this particular church?
I've been here for about 20 years now. I've served as a minister of the Buddhist Churches of America for about 30 years. The Buddhist Churches of America is the Jodo Shinshu, representative of the Jodo Shinshu School of Buddhism. And it's been here for a little over 100 years. And this temple here has been here for about 100 years. I was educated in Hawaii. I served the Hawaii Betsuin. And going around at the different to the different temples, both Oakland, the White River Buddhist Temple, and now this temple, has provided an opportunity to meet a lot of different people and enjoy serving the community.
Now, tell me, what's the difference between a Buddha master and a Buddha priest? Is there a difference?
A Buddha, first of all, a Buddha is just a title of a person who has experienced enlightenment. It is the central concern of all schools of Buddhism. A Buddhist is one who practices the teachings of the Buddha. Sometimes called the Buddha Dharma, or just the Dharma. A Buddhist master could be someone who in, say, a monastic tradition has acquired some degree of knowledge, an area of expertise. And a minister is someone who has been educated, who has resources, that provides him with the ability to serve his community.
Now, I know that if you were Muslim, you would be reading out the Quran. If you were Jewish, the Torah, and maybe Christian, the Bible. Now, what is the basic text?
Now, the basic text of Buddhism, it's encyclopedic.
Interesting.
It's a large collection of sutras. Sutra is a Dharma message that is attributed to the historical Buddha who lived 2,500 years ago. And these sutras were originally passed on orally and were finally written down. And there are about 1,650 of these sutras that have come down through the years. So except for the Tendai school of Buddhism, most traditions will focus on a particular sermon or two or three sermons of Shakyamuni Buddha. This school of Buddhism, Jodo Shinshu, emphasizes the larger Pure Land Sutra, the Meditation Sutra, and the Amida Sutra. These are all sutras that deal with the Buddha Amida and the story or the mythology of Amida Buddha.
Now, would you, in your opinion, now, is Buddhism a religion or is it more of a philosophy?
Scholars have debated this for a long time. I think it's whatever you decided you want it to be. But basically, I think all religions and philosophies really are a way of life. In order for it to be meaningful, philosophy becomes philosophy when we simply think about it. A religion becomes a religion when we analyze it. But when we live it, then it is simply that.
Now, speaking of living and practicing philosophies and religions, now can you tell me in the best of your ability the difference between Western religion and Eastern religion?
Well, I don't know about all of Eastern religion or all of Western religion for that matter, but I think what you're thinking of is that Western religions tend to be theistic and Eastern religions tend to be non-theistic. And if we're looking at these distinctions, I mean, that's a very broad generalization. But if we're looking at this distinction, the theistic traditions and the non-theistic traditions basically have the basic difference would be the existence or non-existence of God and everything that flows from that. In a non-theistic tradition like Buddhism, the origins of the tradition do not come from God. God is not a central concern of Buddhism. Buddhism is concerned with seeing things as they are, you know, with enlightenment. And whether God exists or does not exist, will become apparent if he exists, if he doesn't exist, will become apparent when one is able to see things as they are.
Now, since I'm not a practicing Buddhist, what would you say would be one common myth or something that you would like to dispel that you see out there?
I think with it, for our tradition, a common misunderstanding is that Buddha is like a god. But Buddha is simply, again, a person who has who is enlightened. Anyone can become enlightened. It's in fact the intent of the teachings of the Buddha, the historical Buddha who lived in India 2,500 years ago, is to enlighten everyone, you know, to provide a means through which others can experience that same enlightenment. Enlightenment, being able to see things as they are, also implies a sense of authenticity, of genuineness. It's a way of experiencing life that is true and real.
Very well said. I had another question for you. Now, in terms of a typical day, would you consider this a church and a temple, and what would a service be like here?
The term church or temple has been debated for a long time, whether we use the word church or temple. With the Buddhist churches of America, and you know, in a way, there was an emphasis or a concerted effort to westernize its forms, so we adopted the word church. Before the Second World War, before the establishment of the Buddhist Churches of America as a religious nonprofit organization, we were just a gathering of people, and really that's the sense that the community was brought together under. The term church or temple, when you trace back the origins of the word temple is closer to an understanding of a place that God resides. And church is a place of worship. And so, although here in the West, the common use of the word church generally implies a Western tradition, and a temple implies a non-Western tradition. So, church, temple, I don't know. You know, it's whatever you actually do with within the organizations that is, it's a place of learning, basically.
I notice, so you don't get too hung up on labels as I do.
No, I used to, think that it was important for us to call ourselves a temple, but, you know, the more we became, the more we discussed it, the more we thought about it, it really doesn't matter. It's the content, and this is really a place of learning about our life, about sharing those experiences with others. And so a typical service, Sunday morning, so we have our regular Dharma school service, so we have our adult English service, and in the afternoons we have our Japanese language service. When this tradition came to the United States, there was a real concerted effort to westernize its form, so things like the pews were introduced, the organ, the pulpit, all of these things were introduced, and the services on Sunday, you know, were practices that were followed here, and so they were adopted. And the service, if you were to attend a service, it would not be all that strange. I mean, it would be very much like a Protestant church, where stand up, you sing gathas, which are songs, and you hear a message and you read something together.
So you would say, if I had an apprehension of coming to a Buddhist church, I really shouldn't.
Yeah. It'd come down and, just relax and enjoy.
Well, since I do have you here, I do want to have maybe one deep question I need to ask you. And that is just in terms of the difference between suffering and sin.
Suffering and sin. Sin, I think, my understanding of sin is that it is something that that you have that is innate a part of who you are. Suffering is a way of experiencing the difficulties of life. As a human being, we look at the world and we kind of divide them up into things that we like and we don't like. And things that we don't like causes us suffering. We feel uncomfortable. We feel unhappy. What Buddhism is trying to do is to get rid of that, to resolve those difficulties. And by getting rid of that, it's to see things as they are, not the value that we place on these things, but simply to see things as they are. Someone who's dying of cancer, say, would be a great tragedy. What we discover in that process of living with somebody with cancer, their life is still valuable. You know, they can still enjoy things, and it's not difficult if we choose it not to be.
Thank you for sharing that. Very well said. And maybe you could leave us with some words. I know one of the primary teachings, I'm assuming, in Buddhism is compassion. And can you just tell me, like today, what are some ways I could become more compassionate?
Be excellent to each other. That was Bill and Ted.
We're having an excellent adventure here. We're got some compassion going on here. Yeah. Okay.
Well, you know, be kind. I mean, kindness is not something that just happens. We need to practice it. And practicing means to be aware of the other. You know, work at being aware of the other, and you know, do things that are kind.
Well, in terms of kindness, though, I mean, for me, I don't know, maybe another level of kindness, because kindness is saying please, thank you, and appreciation, but is there more to kindness than just the normal being polite?
Yeah, you know, that normal being polite is helpful as we work our way through the world, and it's a way of beginning to acknowledge the other person. But when we fully acknowledge the other person, we realize that our lives are deeply connected, you know, and we cannot help but treat the other like ourselves. And even more so, that compassion and that kindness is a natural expression of this realization of oneness.
Thank you. So well, son. I hope I could carry some more compassion in my heart today and learn some more ways to be that. Thank you.
What does Obon mean? Obon means to honor the dead, the past people that made it possible for you, for us, like yourself, your parents, your grandparents came here, did the groundwork for you, and is thanking them for all what they've done for us to make it possible for us to be here today. So this is one of the things there that to say honor the dead is kind of odd, but basically that's the truth. That's the basic principle of Obon. To thank the deceased for what they give us today.
How long has this festival been going on? How many years?
We've been having festival here since 1937. We used to be on Jackson Street, and then it got so crowded that we moved over here, and we've been here ever since. So we've been getting larger. Like I just told, we had 914 dancers on the street. If you wait a little longer, I think at 6:30 they'll start dancing. But tonight it'll be a lot less. But one of the largest Obon dancing in Northern California. So last year was 840, this year was less than 914. So that's really spectacular.
Yeah. That's quite a few dancers. What about how many people attend over the years? How many years have you actually been involved with the festival yourself?
I've been involved here for the last 45 years. I chaired it for about 5 or 6 years myself on the early stages as it grew larger and larger. But people attend this, is approximately in 2 days, it will probably hit almost 15,000, I would say. Yes. So you walk in the gymnasium now, it's full of people. You walk in the food court, it's full of people. You come on this, so there's enough people around. I would say pretty close to 15,000 in 2 days.
That's great. What are some of your favorite highlights from the festival over the years?
I think the favorite highlight is how we are more and more integrated. There's more and more non-Japanese coming to join us dancing, and we have like the Christian church group come over here. Even though they're Christian, it's a community type of deal. It's a community festival. It's not, sure, it's a religious point, but then again, they feel that we should all participate. So we have a mixture of all different kind of people here, which makes me feel good that we are doing a job to everybody celebrate together. You know? So that's one of the things that is very, very, I would say, it hits your heart that we are doing something for the community.
What does it take to actually put on a festival like this?
What it takes is a list of about 100 people underneath me. That's when you look at all the subsets of the moving parts of this thing. We start planning in February. I start planning for next year today. Actually, I started last night seeing things I needed to correct. This is my 8th year, you know, and I keep tweaking it, trying to make it perfect. I never thought growing up that I was a perfectionist, but apparently with this thing, I keep going, I can do that better. But yeah, there's monthly meetings for February, and committee of 100, and I don't think I've ever tried to count how many people are actually staffing the booths for 2 full days. What makes it work is that as I wander around and I'll see somebody, a grown-up in Color Spot, in the morning, and then that afternoon they're over in the gyoza booth, and then the next day they're pouring beer, because we don't have enough people to fill all the booths. You know, that's what makes it work. Mm-hmm. And they're not all church members, definitely not Buddhists. They are friends and family. We have people that cook rice overnight so it's ready for the next day. When I first started, I felt sorry for these people because they couldn't start till midnight. I thought, oh, well, what can I do to get them out earlier, get them started or get them out earlier? So I went back, you know, let me learn this process. And I stopped feeling sorry for them because they were having a party back there, you know. The rice got cooked, but it was this social event, and the same people show up every year, and maybe they drag, you know, one of them gets married, so the spouse shows up now, you know, and it just goes on and on and on, you know. And some of these things are family groups that have inherited over the years. The gentleman who is the moderator on the microphone out there and is in charge of the odori, the dancing, I met him when our son started in Tiger Cubs together, and they're both seniors in high school now.
What are the most popular food items here?
Wow. It's hard to tell because you're based on lines, but that may be a production problem. But there's always lines at gyoza. There's always lines at beef and chicken teriyaki, tempura and corn. And I don't know what's because we can't put it out fast enough, or it's that more popular, you know. But
I noticed here on the second day of the festival too, some items are sold out.
Being a 2-day festival, you try and get enough food for both days. Saturday's a busier day. It's usually 60% of everything. For example, for the gyoza booth, we had 960 pounds of gyoza going in yesterday morning. So we would have sold a little over 600 at by formula. They sold 800 pounds of gyoza yesterday. So my wife's job at Obon is to be the gopher. We hit 4 different stores today, wiping them out of gyoza to keep that booth going. The 2 local markets, Santo Market and Nijia, Restaurant Depot, no, I take that back, 5. Restaurant Depot, Ranch 99, and Lions. You know, just, and I keep metering on the corner, and I keep taking more gyoza into the booth. You know, it's that kind of day, you know, which means we had a hell of a weekend, quite frankly. You know.
Do you mind talking about how much money it costs to put on something like this, even though you have a lot of volunteers?
This is the largest single fundraiser the temple has. Having been raised in another religion, they don't do it the same way in keeping the coffers filled. So it probably takes about $100,000 to put this thing on over 2 days. Most of that is in buying the food and supplies. Unfortunately, every year part of it is a capital expense that I didn't anticipate, because this is our 75th year and we keep having to replace things. You know, the canopy was replaced a few years ago. That was $9,000. Oh, the forklift's broken. I got to buy a new forklift. That's $10,000. You know, stuff like that. Yeah. So about $100,000 a year to do the festival, you know, but we still make money.
Do you ever get any negative feedback from anybody at the festival?
Yeah. I mean, your comment about running out of food, right? The festival, really, you know, its roots are religious, you know, so it was, and I'll speak in the past, by them, for them. It's gotten to be more of a community event now, more so since I took over, because I advertise on the radio. So we're bringing in strangers every year. When the Odori starts tonight, I always get introduced, and I always ask the question, by applause, how many are you here for the first time? And it gets more and more every year. Those are the people I'm concerned about. They show up and there's no food and they go away, you know, disappointed, and they may not come back again.
Well, I notice here you are dressed in your kimono and you're out here enjoying the Obon Festival. And tell me, how many times have you been here?
Well, that would be almost every year of my life, but I don't know if I want to share my age. Let's just say probably 30 years.
30
at least. Yeah, I probably missed a couple of years in there. So,
now, do you take part in any part of the festival besides spectator?
Just doing the dancing.
Just.
I'm just doing the dancing, and we just kind of like to come out, and you know, my kids love to play the games, and just kind of like to enjoy being part of the community.
Excellent, excellent. Now, tell me a little bit about you, Karen. Now, how long have you been attending the festival?
Forever. Yeah. Before, my parents have pictures of me when I was 3 years old dancing in Los Angeles. You know, everybody's doing one thing and I'm doing my own thing. But
so this is more of a community affair and a generation for generation.
Uh-huh. Just carries on.
Well, we're about, I don't know, 25 feet up in the air on this scissor lift because I have to rent these in order to build what you see over my shoulder out here. All the lanterns, of course, running across the street are on poles that do not normally exist on the sidewalks the rest of the year. So we need to string cable across the street, down the street. Also, past the big pine tree down there is a 9,000 square foot parking lot, which we turned into one food booth by raising a 9,000 square foot canopy over the top of it and then screening the side 16 feet high. So it takes a couple scissor lifts, a couple of forklifts, and about 20 people a day from last Sunday through yesterday morning, which would have been Saturday, to put this festival together. Everything you see here is stored, except for the rental equipment, in a garage that we have on the property here. It's an amazing amount of square footage we actually have to dedicate for storage just for the festival. Tonight, when the street permit, closure permit ends, everything on the street will disappear probably by 10 o'clock tonight. The center pavilion out there, the highest one, is called the Yagara, and the dance teachers, some of who are professional, are the ones that lead the whole dancing. They also lead the practice sessions we have 2 and 3 weeks ago. As the number of dancers have increased, just 3 years ago we were in the 600s and last night we had over 900, the lines got longer and longer. So as the people came up around the curved ends, they couldn't see the dancers on the Agra and couldn't follow along if they didn't already know the dance. So starting last year, we created just down in front of us here what these mini Yagaras, and there's one at the far end of the pavilion too, and brought up more people who knew the dances so that just about no matter where you were in a dance line, you could see the dance teachers and follow along with some aptitude, I guess. When you look at the dancing, all of a sudden you'll see a solid line of one color. On the inside line down on our right here, everybody in that light-colored happy coat with the turquoise trim represents families from our junior choir, which is the children's choir from fourth grade through high school. My son is in that right now, although he's not dancing. He's working in one of the booths. My wife's down there. It's being led by our choir director. She's the first one. And this represents maybe about two-fifths of our entire choir families. As a side note, the junior choir families are going to Japan next week for 2 weeks. And we will be visiting Kyoto, which is where the mother temple is for this sect of Buddhism, Jodo Shinshu. And then we'll be going to Okayama, which is our sister city. This year happens to be the 50th anniversary of the sister city relationship between Okayama and San Jose. Then we'll be going on to Hiroshima, and we will be there for the morning of August 6th and the anniversary of the bombing, and we'll be participating as part of the memorial service there, which we think is very important to the kids to understand and learn that.
What is your website? How can people find out more information?
It's the church's website, and it's all on there. The easiest way to get here, people coming, it's too late for this year, but I always tell everybody that light rail is only 4 short blocks away, because as you may have figured out, there's no parking within miles of this place right now, you know. This is the one day, this one weekend all year, where we really impose upon our neighbors, you know.
Let me ask you one last question. What's the most popular thing here from feedback?
It depends on your age, really, but everybody's here for the dancing, you know. But the younger people will, well, the youngest people are out at the game booths. the teenagers are here, and my phone's ringing, probably telling me the next delivery's coming. Yep, it is. Now when you get a load over the beer booth, but the dancing is for everybody.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Hello.
More to come from the 72nd Annual Obon Festival.
I had a great time. I really enjoyed listening to the drums. Now I'm excited about signing up for the workshop.
I really enjoyed learning about the Japanese storytelling technique. It was almost wiped out by television. I'm glad to hear that it's still being kept alive.
And although this festival was more centered around religion in the past, it has become now more of a community-based event. But I'm still glad I got to learn a little bit more about Buddhism. You know, it really lifted my spirits.
I got to be lifted up by a man lift that was used to help set up and tear down the event. Let me get some great shots of the closing dances.
Yes, and last night there was over 900 dancers participating, and tonight about 500. And they're going to use a variety of props with fans, headbands, and kachi-kachis.
We're going to leave you now with coverage of the closing night dances.
Yes, and look real close, because in one of the performances, they're actually playing a game, not only just dancing. And it's, you know that famous game, Rock, Paper, Scissors?
I'm Rich.
I'm Joni.
We're always looking for fun.
And we hope we brought you some, because
we're the fun addicts.
Yeah.
For more information, visit our website, funaddicts.tv.